to start, so let me recall what has happened on the last week. So in the first two lectures, I defined Schur measures and Schur processes, which was the main goal of these introductory lectures. And then, as I said, we will have like three fairly independent parts of this course. So today, I will continue to speak about some combinatorial structure about Reske algorithm. So it's also quite standard material, mostly. And then on the next two lectures, we will discuss asymptotics. So we will start to discuss asymptotics starting from the next lecture. So in the next two lectures, we will discuss global asymptotics of Schur processes and more general measures. And on the last three lectures, we will discuss local asymptotics of these models. So for today, my goal is to discuss combinatorics. And the most important goal is to introduce RSK algorithm once more. So I tried to do this last time, but I will repeat it today and prove some of its properties that will be important for us. So actually, combinatorial structure of RSK is very rich, and I will mention only some part of these properties. Namely, I will be interested in the fact that RSK algorithms generates Schur measures, samples Schur measures and Schur processes, and also the fact that the first row of Yarg diagram it can be nicely encoded in terms of RSK. So these are two facts that I'm going to prove today, and this is my main goal. But also in the second part of this lecture, I will try to give certain generalization of this picture. So this will be more like advertisement, so I will give no proofs, just statements. So what happens if we consider not Schur processes, but whole Littlewood processes? So it turns out that the same story, whole Littlewood processes, RSK, can be, well, it's some part can be told about whole Littlewood functions, and we will obtain some result for yet another model, which is called stochastic six-vertex model. But this will be only just by statements, not there will be no proofs. So and my main goal is to talk about RSK, so I'll recall so these are references that I gave last time. And my main goal is to, so my first main goal is to describe like basic step of RSK. So the input, so this is a certain, this basic step is a certain algorithm which takes as an input three Young diagrams, lambda, mu, lambda, and nu, with certain interrelation conditions such that mu interlaces with lambda and mu interlaces with nu. And also it takes as an input one non-negative integer. And I want to define some fairly complicated procedure how to generate a Young diagram row, which also satisfies certain interrelation conditions, namely lambda interlaces with row and also nu interlaces with row. And so I will depict such interrelation constraints and interrelation, such interrelation conditions by the following picture. So if I have lambda above of mu, that means that mu interlaces with lambda. And also if I have mu and nu, that means that mu interlaces with nu. So it will be just some convenient picture to have in mind. So my goal is to define this procedure. So I tried to do this last time, but I will repeat this probably with some examples and some pictures and in a more algorithmic way. So some questions about this goal. Okay, let us start. So I will try to make one more small step and to define, so this is not conventional notation, micro update. So this is also some algorithm which takes as an input two Young diagrams, mu, tilde mu and tilde lambda, and also one integer j, such that mu tilde mu interlaces with lambda tilde lambda, and also they can be depicted by like these particles. So I want to have n particles on the lower level and n plus one particle on the upper level. And for Young diagrams, I can always consider them as signatures just by adding some c zeros at the end. So this is not a constraint as we discussed in the last week. And as a result of this like very small update, micro update, I want to obtain two interlacing signatures to Young diagrams, tilde mu and tilde lambda. I will denote them by the same letters, but they are updated, so they will change a little bit. But I will use the same letters. So what is this step? So this J tells me what particle wants to jump. So let us look at this example. So if we have 2,5 as tilde mu and 1,3,6 as tilde lambda, and if we take as this input J, particle number 2, that means that the particle number 2 wants to jump one step to the right. So this particle will jump anyway. We just need to say what will happen with the row with Young diagram tilde lambda. And there can be just two different situations. So if this particle tilde mu j, so I think this is tilde mu j, is less than lambda tilde lambda j, so it's less, is strictly less than this particle, then it pulls its left neighbor. So this jumps happens anyway, from 2 to 3, it will happen anyway, but this particle 1 will become particle 2 here. So both Young diagrams, so there is like just one jump on this lower level and one jump on the upper level, and I described what these jumps were. Also, there is another case if this particle, this second particle wants to jump, but this breaks interlacing conditions. So I always want to have interlacing signatures, interlacing Young diagrams, and if this interlacing constraint is broken, then it must push this particle, must push its right neighbor. So in this case, this particle jumps from 2 to 3, and also this particle 2 will jump to this point 3. So this is like two simple cases what happens if a particle on the bottom level wants to jump one step to the right. So more formally, well, we anyway do this operation till the mu j is increased by 1, and we have, well, either this particle is increased by 1 or this particle is increased by 1, which corresponds to left and right neighbors. Yes, and this is this example written like in terms of lengths of rows. So any questions about this? Yeah, so we will not apply this situation. If we have like 2,2 here, we will not apply this separation. So well, it's formally defined, but I will not apply this to this situation. So this is like non-canonical. Well, this is just so more canonical step will be the next one, like step of RSK. This is just like for convenience. Questions? So, in this language of interlacing particles, so probably I need to say that RSK is like classical description is with the use of semi-standard Young tableau, insertion, bumping. What I describe is it's just the same description on the language of particles. And one reason why I do this is that because of this generalization to whole Littlewood functions, which probably in these generalizations, it's slightly more convenient to think about particles. But for classical RSK, for Schur RSK, of course, it's more classical to talk about semi-standard Young tableau. But anyway, so now I want to define this basic step of RSK algorithm. Again, we have three Young diagrams, mu, lambda, and nu, and also one non-negative integer as input. And we want to produce one Young diagram row. So how will we do this? So we will, again, so this is a fairly algorithmic description. So we use tilde mu, tilde lambda, just two signatures with length n and n plus 1. And we think about them that they They are updated step by step. So there are several updates of these signatures. So initially, they will start from mu and lambda. And then by a series update, we will obtain another Young diagram tilde lambda, which will be declared as rho as a result of this algorithm. And the algorithm itself is, when we have this like very basic micro update, it can be written in the following way. So first, just look at the particle number n, the last particle from mu and lambda, and do this micro update exactly mu n minus mu n times. So we need to have, we need to use like all three signatures, mu, lambda, and mu. And this description actually breaks the symmetry of this operation, which is slightly bad, but it has like some other advantages. So I use mu and lambda in a non-symmetric way. So I start like tilde mu and tilde lambda are my updated particles, and then I use mu as description how this, so how many micro updates I should apply. So this n, particle number n should jump mu n minus mu n times, and it will cause some updates on the upper level tilde lambda. Then I will do the same for the particle number n minus 1. I will do this mu n minus 1 minus mu n minus 1 times, etc. I do this for each particle from the left to the right. I do several of these very basic micro update steps. At the end, I will do this for first particle. And then at the very end, I need also to use this input r. I just increase tilde lambda 1 by this r. So this is a series of micro updates. And at the end, I obtain some Young diagram tilde lambda, which I said that this is output rho. So at this point, of course, it's not clear why should we do all of this. And I will try to prove some properties of this procedure. But let us first, of course, look at the example how it works Yes, both. So each this very small step increases by one, both bottom level and upper level, and then only this step increases. Or this step increases only upper level. So at the end, I will have this condition. Okay, sure. So we will have an example of how this procedure is applied. Yeah, but in this step we either push this right neighbor or pull left neighbor.
At the end of your algorithm, you discard the
tilde. Yeah. So I'm just interested in this row. So everything else is just not very important. Yeah, but I know this like from the beginning. Yes. So at the end, tilde mu will be just mu. So just by these jumps. Yes, that's. So mu is just like description. So how these particles want to jump? How particles from mu wants to jump?
What you said is that mu tilde.
Yes, mu tilde it will be new.
But that's rather evident. You move mu, the micro update is completely deterministic on the bottom half. So you just.
Yeah, so more questions? Okay, let us look at the example. So initially I have 2, 5. The bottom 1, 3, 6 on the upper level, and also I have mu 4, 7. So I will depict these positions by red dots. So I think about this like black dots are given initially, and red dots are like our instruction how particles on the bottom should jump. So what we will do, so and also I have like r equals 3 is also part of an input. So how this update goes on? We start from the last particle, which is this 2, and we move this 2 to 4. So how it will result, what jumps will happen on the upper level? When we do, so we need to do 2 micro updates. like by this definition. On the first micro update, this 2 will jump to 3, and it will pull this 1 into 2. And on the second step, this 3 will jump into 4, and it will push this 3 into 4, because we will have in the second case of micro update. So after this first step, we will obtain 2, 4, and 4. And this is a result of a jump of the last particle, like second particle here. Next, we need to make these jumps for the first particle, 5. And again, it will have, so first this 5 should pull this 4. So again, so note that it was 3 initially, then it was pushed by this particle, and then it will be pulled by this particle on the next step. So that's why the order why we are doing this is important. So when we jump from 5 to 7, it will result into particles 5 and 7. And at the end, I need to use input 3 and just add it to this 7, it will be 10. Interlace by our conditions on mu and nu, black and red interlace. So it always here like black, red, black, red. Yeah, so we never applied micro update in the situation when we have some problems.
The number of non-zero parts of row will be the number of non-zero parts of lambda.
So if we might have some zeros here. They also like might somehow interact, yes. But they will interact in the same rule, so yeah. So for example, if you try to do this procedure with lambda and mu, if we change places lambda and mu, then to do this procedure, we will need to add zeros. But at the end, we will obtain also 2, 5, 10. This is probably an exercise. Probably with some, again, with some particles at zero. This is not clear from this description. So output is Young diagram 2, 5, 10. Okay? So this is like basic step. This is like quite canonical basic step that we will study today. So why do we need this? Okay, so let us try to establish some properties of this basic step. So the first property that I will need is that we actually can invert this procedure. Namely, if we start with rho lambda and nu, so lambda, we again have some information about lambda and nu, but now we have rho instead of these red things, mu and input r. We can, by inversion, we can obtain this mu and r, and this is, so they always exist and they always are unique. So I think that like the best way to think about this is about the, like this picture. So if we know this part, then we know this corner, and if we know this part, then we know input and bottom left corner. So how to prove this? So it's short, but let us try to figure out what to do. So first, I claim that I can define, I can determine input r by using this formula. So rho 1 minus maximum of lambda 1 and mu 1. So it only includes rho, lambda, and mu, so it gives me some number. But why is this correct? So let us try, so any ideas, why is this correct? From the description. So we have this description of jumps. So how to see that we have this? If we don't know this r, we can still determine it.
The last step is just increasing the biggest part of lambda by r.
Yeah. Yeah, but we do not know. So this is this should be new one. So there are many intentional mistakes here, of course. Please correct me. So this is correct formula. So we do not know mu, but we know lambda and nu. So let us see what can happen with first particle. So indeed, the very last step is increasing by r. But also, this particle can be, there can be some interactions before. So it could be pushed by tilde mu 1. So it can be that tilde mu 1 was here. Or it can be that it wasn't pushed and we need to use, this tilde mu 1, which is the same as mu 1. Or it can happen that it wasn't pushed by this first particle from the bottom level, and in this case we need to use lambda 1. So if it was pushed, then we can use mu 1, and if not, then we use lambda 1, and this determines this input. So we will see also this on the example, but this is like first part, and we will need this equality once more today. So how to determine input? If we know input, so we can do this like very last step, and what remains are micro updates. And every micro update can also be inverted. So if we know this one small jump on the upper level, we can, in a unique way, understand what happened below. Well, this is a certain statement. I will just show it in the example. By writing these rules, it will be quite clear what is happening. And in fact, we can notice that what is happening is that we just rotate the picture, so we think about bottom level as a top level and top level as a bottom level and use the same rules. And this will give us, there is also like this, after this rotating picture or head by 180 degrees, we obtain the same rules and the same procedure how to obtain this Young diagram mu. So let us see how this works on the very same example. So since this is inversion, we need to start with bottom right corner. So that's what we know. We know, so red particles are lambda 136, and mu and rho are interlacing Young diagrams, which are represented by these black particles, 2, 4, 5, 7, 10. So first we need to understand what was the input. So we do not know, so if we start with these three Young diagrams, we do not know an input, and the first thing that we do, we determine the input. So if we had this description of RSK algorithm, like from top to below, so it was do micro update for last particle, et cetera, do micro update for the first particle, and do this increasing of first particle, then we do just the same steps in the opposite direction. So initially we start with this configuration. So we have, this is like lambda 1, this is mu 1. So what has happened here? It's clear that initially we had lambda 1 here, then this particle was pushed by from below, and then there was some jump. So if we want to figure out what was this jump, we just need to put this particle from 10 to 7 here. This is maximum of 7 and 6. So are there any questions about this combinatorics? So yes. What was the last step? So for inversion, this is the first step. We subtract this R back. So this configuration was obtained after all micro updates, and R is uniquely determined by this step by this first arrow. So and then we need to invert micro-updates. So we start from this 7, and we think about this particle as this particle wants to jump to 6. But again, we always want to have interlacing signatures, interlacing Young diagrams. So if this particle 7 jumps to 6, then this particle 7 also jumps to 6. This is an inversion of micro-update. And this is exactly the same, actually the same rules. So they coincide, so it should be both 6 here. So this is the inversion of like one line of micro-updates for the first particle. Then this particle 5 wants to jump back to 3. On the first step, just like by how micro-update was worked, this 5 must pull this particle 6 back. And then this particle 4, it will push this particle 4 to the left. So it will be 3, 5 here. So both particles move to the left by 1, and we have this move from 5 to 3. And finally, we need just to consider the last jump from 2 to 1. It pulls this particle 3 back into 2. So just basically by using the same rules, we recovered our initial Young diagram 2, 5. Any questions about this? So this will be like very important for bijection. So if this, so this is like some inversion of this algorithm. An additional nice fact that we use almost the same rules. So this proposition is proved. Is everybody agree? Any objections? Okay. So now, so this was quite a canonical step. And now I will want to apply it several times. Well, so we have some corollary that if we fix lambda mu, we have a bijection between pairs mu R and Young diagrams rho. So bijection is not very surprising because both the sets are countable, but this is like some very special bijection which has some nice properties, and in particular it has a property that, well, this inequality about sums about number of boxes in Young diagrams, about the sums of all these numbers. So now we will use this basic step to construct the whole fields of Young diagrams. So the construction will be the following. So we can add a box. So we start with this configuration empty and consider that all Young diagrams along horizontal and vertical line are empty. And then we fill this field by inputs. So R11, R21, etc. are just non-negative integers. And we have an operation which takes these three Young diagrams and input and give us the fourth Young diagram here. So this will be our first step. Then we will make next step and we'll obtain Young diagram here. Then here. So we will doing the steps one by one. We will add one box and obtain some fairly non-trivial picture for such arrays of integers. So and we start just with empty conditions, so everything is defined in terms of these integers R11 or R21, etc. Yeah, so that's what is written here. If we know Young diagrams in point KL, KL plus 1, and K plus 1 L, then we apply this RSK and obtain Young diagram at the point K plus 1, L plus 1. And this is a procedure which gives us some uniquely determined Young diagram if we are given these inputs. And by construction, we always had interlacing conditions. So for example, if we look at this downright path of Young diagrams, then we always have this interrelation. So draw it in this way, one above another, exactly to have this picture. So if we have adjacent Young diagrams either in this way or in this way, we always have interrelation condition in such an array. For each edge, we have interrelation condition for Young diagrams. So for this path, we have empty set interlaces with lambda 1, 3. This is this one. And the same for all this path. So sometimes it's at corners, we have interrelation in this direction, interrelation in this direction, then again interrelation like this, so on. So we obtain this structure, which is probably slightly familiar because that's what we discussed during the first two lectures, the structure of Young diagrams which interlace, sequences of Young diagrams which interlace in a certain way. So this will be, of course, a Schur process when we introduce some probability into this picture.
Yeah. That the inequalities were alternating, right?
So inequalities can interlace. Well, not interlace, I mean, so you do you mean this interlacing?
In the last previous lectures, there were first one inequality, then on the other side, and there were.
Yeah. So that's. So for general Schur process, we have all like something like this, then this. So we can take arbitrary specializations. So in this actually a property of Schur process, which I didn't discuss in detail, that we can take like just empty specialization. So we can it was picture like up, down. But if we take this specialization like empty, then we will obtain a picture like this. So these two arrows will both go up in a certain sense. But we don't need, strictly speaking, this now, and we can see this for the structure of RSK, how this works. But Schur processes cover all situations when we have arbitrary interlacing here and there, so this was like a general definition, and we can obtain a structure like this by taking empty specialization. Yeah, but this is a very good question. Thank you. Yeah. If in this picture, if all R are zero, that we just obtain all empty Young diagrams, nothing is happening.
Nothing happens if
all R.
Because you start with empty diagrams.
Yes. So
if they are not empty diagrams,
then something can happen. So if they are like different fixed Young diagrams, then we will have some life here. Yes.
That's
more complicated than Schur processes. So for Schur processes, we have like some nice product formulas coming from cachet identity. And if we like consider something something more complicated, it's not all the situations like this are analyzed actually.
And if all R are equal to 1,
no, that's usually RSK. It's. Yeah, but that's like the first RSK that was discovered, probably, in this sense, at least. Yes, but these R's, if all these R's are one, well, we do have some life. It's something not very trivial.
The oldest thing is the R's form of permutation.
Yeah, sure. So like more classical situations, if this is like first a rectangle, so I consider this downright path, which is like more complicated, but if this is rectangle, and in this rectangle we have just ones and zeros, and in each row and each column we have only one and all other zeros, this is historically the first case, and also if we have some words, so it was first discovered for some particular examples of such arrays, and in this form it was first discovered by Donald Knuth, I think, for rectangles. So we have this interlacing conditions, nothing for probabilities for now, because we need to prove Second bijection. So second bijection or second proposition. So it's bad because the formulation is much longer than a proof. So that basically describes what is happening when we do several such steps. Several we add one box several times. So we obtain some lambdas. But the claim is first that we have a bijection between these inputs and lambda with interlacing conditions. And second, that we have way how to connect the sums along each row and each column with sizes of Young diagrams. So let me draw it somewhere. So how to think about this? So if we have downright path, R11, Rij, Rij here. So what stands from the on the left of this equality? I just consider some column and say that this column crosses this downright path exactly once. So I have some Young diagram here, and I have some Young diagram here. And on the right-hand side of this equality stands the difference between the amount of boxes here and here. So for each, so I fix some column, and I can consider this difference of boxes. And on the left-hand side stands this Rij in this exactly column. So if I sum all this Rij, this what is written here, probably a little bit more formally, is that the sum of all this Rij is exactly the difference between the number of boxes in these two Young diagrams. And then the same for each row. For each row, we intersect exactly once. I have two lambdas here, and I subtract from this amount of boxes this amount of boxes. So there is a claim that this lambdas, which I obtain by this procedure, has this property. And another claim is that this is bijection between the set of all Rij below this downright path. And Young diagrams with interlacing constraints that I defined, that each neighbor should interlace. So this is a description of what is happening when we do these several basic steps. So I have any questions about this formulation, so because it's involved. And it's not that clear how to see this on the example, because we make several basic steps. So each Rij participates in one row and one column, so in two sums. So probably, so how to prove? The proof is very easy. Yeah.
In the two equations, minus one should be on the first column?
No, so this Young diagram is larger than this one. So it's because it's above.
In both cases, you are removing one from L.
Oh, yes. Yes, this should be, yeah. That's true, thank you. So this should be lambda. K. So KL minus one is bad. So I should subtract from K. From K. L minus lambda. K minus one. Something like this. But anyway, so I just tried unsuccessfully to describe what happens when we take row and we must have only one intersection with this downright path. So it's probably much more clear than all these sums which are written wrong.
Yeah.
frankly speaking, I don't understand. So what do you mean?
There is this map that takes all the arcs
yeah.
to all the row and constants, which are much less.
Yeah.
For example, something that is sent to zero is plus, minus, minus, plus, on squares, the large kernel of this.
Okay, yeah. So we can see the only non-negative integers, yes, but yeah. From linear algebra point of view, yes, of course. Yeah, of course, yeah. And it's true. So the proof, so probably this is a rare situation when the proof clarifies things. So proof is just two lines. We just add boxes one by one, so we need to prove two statements, bijection and this condition that we have sums of inputs inside each row and inside each column. So when we need to prove bijection, so well, we have a map in one, so we have a map from inputs to lambdas, but if you start from lambdas and just we remove one by one boxes, we will also, in a unique way, determine all inputs. And to get a condition about this R, about this sums of inside each column, we need to use this condition for a basic step. So we always know that the difference between Young diagram here and here is larger than the difference between these two Young diagrams by R, and then when we add next step, we will obtain that. Well, we will obtain two sums in sums of R's in these two boxes, etc. Finally, we will get this equality here. So this is just follows from this step-by-step procedure, and the same, of course, for rows. They should interlace, so I haven't written this explicitly. They should interlace in the sense that, this is this condition. So we can apply inversion for three Young diagrams which satisfy interlacing conditions. And that's enough. You know, so like inputs will care about the sizes of these Young diagrams. So we start with a corner like this, and we can construct this.
Yeah.
And then after this we can add this box, like remove this box.
That's fine. So now at the end, when you want to access,
what one? So we will have something like this. So here we will have empty set. We have lambdas, and it will be uniquely determined. Input here will be uniquely determined. So now we will need this statement for. We will want to apply this statement for sampling of Schur measures. So I just recall that evaluation of skew Schur function at one variable, it's a very simple thing, is a to the power amount of boxes in lambda minus amount of boxes in mu. So and this skew Schur function is exactly what is is present in the definition of Schur process. Yes, and so in more standard situation is indeed, so probably I need to say that more standard situation is if we have downright path like this, then we have these rectangles which filled by non-negative integers, and we will have a map from this to interrelation Young diagrams along these rows, and along this path, along this horizontal level and along this vertical level. So this is probably what is written in Wikipedia for RSK algorithm for such a thing. And this is a like slight generalization. Sorry? Yeah, probably. Yeah, it was yesterday. Yes, yeah, I should say that it was yesterday it was written in Wikipedia. Okay, so now I want to understand what should I do to obtain a Schur measure. So Schur measure, by definition, was like some probability which is proportional to the product of two Schur functions, two Schur polynomials. I will use polynomials here. So today I will not use like beta specializations. In the proof, I will prove everything only for alpha specializations and only for finitely many of them. And then this product of two Schur functions can be written by a combinatorial formula as a large sum, which I wrote in terms of like this path. So lambda mn equals lambda is fixed, and then I sum over all interlacing arrays here, which corresponds to like the first Schur function in the product, and I sum over all interlacing arrays here, which corresponds to the second interlacing array in this product. So I will have, like, by definition of Schur measure, I have this sum with fixed lambda. If lambda is fixed, then lambda of mn is fixed. And yes, and I sum over all interlacing conditions here. So probably we need to look at this formula and notice that, so of course I want to apply RSK, so I have interlacing arrays here and here. This is exactly what I like. So if I have this interlacing array and interlacing array here, I have some Rij, but I also have some condition on the sums of this Rij. So if I have some fixed Rij, it is included in one column here and in one row here. So it somehow participates in this difference of the sizes of Young diagrams and in this one. So in this difference we have a I raised to the power of this difference by this formula. And here we have bj. Or probably better to write it here, bj. So if you want somehow to reproduce this weight, then rij should be proportional to ai and b, times bj. Because then we will have sums of this rij. So that's how to see the following statements, that we just need to generate this Rij, our inputs, by geometric distributions. So now I finally introduce some probability here. I consider geometric distribution for Rij, x from 0, 1, 2. So I hope that this is given by this formula. Well, it seems more or less correct. And I do this independently for each box in this rectangle. Then I will, this x will be like Rij, and then I will exactly obtain this structure of summing things like Ai, sum of Rij will become Ai times difference of Young diagrams in the, well, in the points when this row or column crosses the boundary. So the statement is, like the statement without, we don't see RSK explicitly here, the statement is that if we take such array of integers and consider geometric independent geometric distributions at each of these points, this Young diagram will be distributed as the Schur measure whose parameters a1, an, b1, bn. So that's what is written here as proposition 3a. And here I just try to describe how to see that we indeed need like these geometric distributions and independence. So some questions about this? So about the statement and like somehow. So the idea how to prove is, well, just understand the statement of proposition 2. So for rectangles, we have this bijection, and more general statement is that if we again consider the same independent geometrically distributed random variables, but do this for some downright path. So we have here, 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 and here, independent identically distributed random variables whose parameters ai times bj. So for example, here we consider a2 b, b2 the power rij. When we generate rijs, then we obtain on the bar on the this downright path, we obtain a Schur process. So for Schur process we need some specializations. So they are written here. Let us do like in this example, it will be if this point is 0, n, 2, this will be m2, n2, this will be m2, n1. This will be. Okay, so I just probably need to start with just to denote all these points as mi and I on the boundary. In such a way that mi decreases and ni increases. Then specialization is just specialization into one variable which stands, which corresponds to this row. So I want to make a statement that for any downright path, the Young diagrams, random Young diagrams which I obtained here, is a Schur process. To do this, I need specializations. And I'm trying to describe what specializations I need. So I need for this step, I need a specialization to one alpha variable, which stands, so I just wrote A1, A2, AM here, B1, BN there, and I have exactly one part of this path which corresponds to this BI, and this specialization will be into this alpha variable BI. And when I have, so this is a downright path, if I have step to the right, this is what we have, so what was denoted by rho I plus. So this is a specialization which goes up. And if I have step down, then this is specialization into, which goes down. So this is probably a little bit confusing. So Schur process is a complicated object, and I probably don't want to give like all details to describe this precisely. But the idea is the following. So first, we just consider Schur processes like which takes one step either to the right or down, and for such Schur process, this is just a definition of Schur process. So we just write this Q Schur function evaluated and one variable, and we exactly obtain the same relations which we have from proposition two about sums of inputs along each row and each column. And then we need a statement that if we take just some of these points, then we will also have a Schur process for some other specializations. So all the statements are visible from RSK algorithm, but probably so I wrote just like the idea of proof, so it's probably better to make this as an exercise, so how to see how this definition of skew Schur functions with interrelation arrays exactly transforms into like the structure of Schur process with these points. So but is like, first of all, is the statement like somehow clear without the specialization part, so that if we applied RSK to this to everything which is below downright pair, then we obtain a Schur process. That's probably a thing that like just a statement like this. And it can be proved by applying this RSK that I formulated. Some questions? Okay, so this is a way how to sample Schur processes. So this is a way how to sample arbitrary Schur processes with alpha variables. So as we remember, there are beta specializations and there is also a gamma specialization. So not much, but still two more cases. And probably this is good. This is a good place to say about something about this. Okay, so let me first say about Cauchy identities. So I promise that we will prove Cauchy identity by using RSK. So if you just multiply, so in the definition of geometric distribution, we have this 1 minus AI BJ. And in order to see partition function of Schur measure, we just need to multiply all these 1 minus AI BJ for all boxes below this downright path. And if we have more complicated downright path, exactly again, we just need to multiply this 1 minus AI BJ for each box. So partition functions, we need to invert. So if we want to write a sum, then we need to invert and consider powers minus 1. So this RSK algorithm, well, in this proposition 2, gives us partition functions, Cauchy identities, skew Cauchy identities, which allow to compute partition functions for Schur process and for Schur measure. So this also comes from this geometric distribution. Actually, this bijection somehow provides more information, but these are corollaries. So these are partition functions for alpha specialization. So I didn't talk about partition functions for beta specializations. So in principle, this can be done by the same scheme. So we just need another basic step. So what I described was like some procedures of how to obtain from three Young diagrams and an input fourth Young diagram. So if we will start with another, so there is a certain choice. One can start with column insertion, which I will briefly discuss a little bit later. But one can also start also row insertion, for example, but which generates beta specialization, not alpha specialization as we have here, but beta specialization. So I will not discuss this, but this is possible and the scheme is exactly the same. So we just analyze first properties of this basic step and then a statement about general Schur processes with arbitrary alpha and beta specializations here and here will appear more or less automatically by this scheme. Also, there is a gamma parameter, and gamma parameter can be obtained by a certain degeneration from, for example, from this situation, from alpha parameters, if we consider, I think I wrote this, that if you consider AI equals 1 over n, and I range from 1 to n. Probably I will write gamma here. And consider n tends to infinity limit. So So error scale algorithm will also work for after this degeneration, and actually it becomes simpler, and this is historically the first version of error scale algorithm, and probably the most important part of this algorithm, which deals with permutation. Or another way to see to think about this is that consider Poisson process in the first quadrant. Then, after applying a suitable version of RSK, we will have here Schur measure with gamma specializations. If you make this limit transition for A's and also for B's, so if we may, we will make both these AIs and BJs. So we will obtain some picture like something like this. So this scheme, this discrete scheme, is more complicated combinatorially, unfortunately, but it allows to generate arbitrary Schur measures and Schur processes. Any questions? Yes, yes. So we know that this is, so this will be, so this is a very good question. So this will be a staircase, and also with alpha and beta specialization. So it will be alphas here, specializations, and beta here. So if we will know how to deal with beta specialization, this will be possible to sample from Aztec diamond. And also there are actually other dynamics which, so this is not the only one. So RSK is somehow special dynamics which generates Schur processes, but there are also other dynamics which also generates Schur processes, which we will not discuss, but so there exists like a certain number of dynamics how to generate Aztec diamond, how to generate Schur processes. But from RSK it's also possible. Yeah, so that's an interesting question, so how to generate a beta specialization, but I'm afraid that I don't have time for this. So I'm just trying to describe like the main line for alpha specializations. So I need to say like one more important property of Schur measure. So, and this is convenient moment to do so. So the first row of Young diagram distributed according to the Schur measure has very nice and simple interpretation. So again, first of all, let us formulate a statement without probability. So consider matrix. So here is the matrix of 3x3. I don't know. We probably can think about some Rebsberries, which we collect. So we go from, we are here, we go to our home, which is here. We need to be fast, so we use only upright paths, but we want to collect some Rebsberries during this process, and we want to collect as many of them as possible. How to do this using upright paths? So the formal definition is here. So we maximize the sums of Rij over paths which look somehow like this. So we can go like this or this. So we just can move either up to or to the right. And we are maximizing this sum. So how to get this, so this function is a maximum. So how to get in an optimal way to this point? Well, we start here, so we always have these two. Then we can move either this direction or this direction. So I only two ways. And of course, this is better. So in this way, we get four. Then 3, 2 is 8, so we need to go here. Okay, so 2, 1, 1, 4. This is 8, hopefully. Then if we need to go into this point, then the best way is not this one, but this one. So we want to collect this 3, and then it will be 2 plus 3 plus 1, it will be 6. And finally, to go here, we need probably something like this, and this will be this 9. So this is quite a natural question. So what happens in this situation? What happens with the quantity g of mn is if these inputs are somehow randomly distributed. So if they are independent random variables. So what can we say about this G of M n? And it turns out, and this is like probably some manifestation of integrable probability, that we can have a very nice and very precise information if we have some very specific distribution on these random variables, namely geometrical random variables, or Bernoulli, but well, for us it will be geometrical, geometrically distributed random variables. But if you have some arbitrary distribution, we don't know much. So it's quite clear that the situation should be the same, that nothing like the asymptotic should not depend on this distribution significantly if you consider like uniform distribution or like some other natural distributions. But this is not as, much less is known in these situations for some other natural distributions. But if we have geometrical distributions, for exactly the reason of this RSK, we have very precise information. And the reason for this is that for geometrical distributions, we have Schur measures. So, but let us first see why this G of Mn is connected to first row of Young diagram. And it will be not be very hard to prove. So if we have a matrix of Rij, we construct lambda of Mn as before by RSK algorithm. And we want to prove, so no probability here, that G of Mn is lambda 1 of Mn. So the first row, lambda 1 is the first row of Young diagram. And the proof is actually, so the construction that I used is quite well suitable for the proof of this statement. Because we have this condition, we already used this condition when we defined input in the inversion. So this is exactly, we need to take a maximum of mu and lambda, and then add input. So this was exactly the thing how we define input in the inversion. But for this quantity G of n, we have exactly the same thing because, well, so if we want to get to some point, Mn. So any upright path is coming either here or here. There are just two options for upright path. And for this point, we have G of k plus 1. So this is k plus 1 L. And for this point, we have k L plus 1. So we just need to maximize from these two numbers and add this input, which stands at this point, we always have the last input. And we obtain exactly the same relation for these quantities. And just by induction, we immediately obtain this statement. So this construction is quite suitable for this proof. So now, if Rij becomes random, then lambda of Mn becomes distributed as a Schur measure. And we know that G of Mn is the first row of this random Young diagram. And this is how the results about G of Mn are obtained, because of this structure of Schur measure. So any questions about this one additional piece of combinatorics? Okay, so I think that I will not prove anything else during this lecture, but I will state a couple of more theorems or propositions. But this was probably like the basic part of this lecture to see that Schur measure has also this interpretation. So there are also some other way how to define row insertion RSK for alpha specialization. So it's called column insertion or dual RSK. So I will not define it right now, but I'll just say that it has some almost the same properties. So it also allows to generate bijections. So there are different bijections, but also bijections between the same objects that we have seen and with the same properties. So also there is inversion, but proposition, the last proposition about the longest, like longest increasing subsequence or this last passage percolation, this combinatorial statement takes a different form. And I will formulate this in probably not very standard way in order to generalize this statement for whole Littlewood functions. So, but as for now, just some another algorithm of the same sort, also like some particles, moves, pushes, pulls, which has almost the same properties, but this combinatorial statement is different. So these Rij are, as before, some matrix with non-negative values, but now I will make from this matrix some other matrix. I will put ones at points when I have an input which is greater or equal to one and zero if it was zero. So this is a matrix of dots, basically. So this is a 4x4 matrix with, when I have this dot, then I have this input which is greater or equal to one. If not, then not. So that what remains this dot that's what remains from these pictures, our previous pictures with Rijs. So for like classical RSK, we considered all upright paths. Now I will try to formulate the equivalent property in equivalent to this, not equivalent but like similar property, in terms of a certain vertex model. This will be actually a 5-vertex model because these are Schur functions. This will be a certain 5-vertex model. So I start with these dots, I do some combinatorial procedure, and I obtain some picture with horizontal and vertical lines. I obtain this picture. So let me try to describe how did I obtain this picture. So these are, like my input are this 4x4 matrix. And these are horizontal line. I take all horizontal line coming from the left. I take no vertical lines coming from here. So these are, my, in some sense, the boundary conditions. And then I do something with these horizontal lines. So this is like my initial condition. And then I move from the left to the right and explain what happens in this picture using the certain rules. So this is a certain combinatorial construction which plays the same role as this statement about the first row for another version of RSK. So it is a version of matrix ball construction, probably to say some words which are typically used here, Fulton matrix ball construction. So on each level, we have either one line or zero lines. And also on each vertical edge, we have either one line or zero lines. This is like our first rule. Second rule, that this picture is formed by upright paths, well, which principally can intersect. So we need to have a structure of upright paths here. Next, so how these dots are plane. So we start with the first column, and first look here. If no dot is here, nothing will happen. Then we look here. So horizontal line meets a dot. That means that this horizontal line should go up, and then it should stop at the first non-occupied level when it again becomes horizontal. So this is a rule, but in this first column, there is no non-occupied level. From both these levels are occupied, so this line just goes, becomes vertical and goes infinitely to the up, infinitely up. Then this dot plays no role because, well, we already have some vertical line. If we have vertical line coming from below, then this horizontal line just goes to the right, and this horizontal line is doing the same instead, despite the fact that we have no dot here. So that's, I tried to explain what happened on the first column. So there are some combinatorial construction. Next, we do the same for the second column. So in the second column, this horizontal line meets this dot, and it goes up only one level because this level is not occupied. And on this level, it turns right without dependence on this dot. Also, this horizontal line goes up and, well, goes vertically after this. So these dots are certain signals which says to the horizontal line, let's turn up. And then this vertical line turns to the right on the first non-occupied level. So briefly speaking, it's description like this. Okay, some combinatorial construction. So this is deterministic combinatorial construction. If we have dots, then we have some picture which is constructed by these rules. But probably, well, some questions about these rules. So initial conditions, another conditions, and well, this rule about turning to the right or turning up.
What happens if two lines, one vertical and a horizontal, cross at the dot?
So it's not relevant whether there is a dot in this point or not. It's just, it is like either here or here, just cross in any way, in any case. So this one and this one are also not different from each other. So this dot plays no role. So in both these cases, it just turns right.
What's important is that there's no line coming.
Yes, back. Yeah. So we have no line here. So it just must turn to the right. Okay, so this is not that natural what we did as we did before with Simon. Of an upright pattern, but it will be natural from some other point of view. But as for now, this is a deterministic picture, and this deterministic picture can be described in the terms of height function. So that's probably what I want to say now. Yeah, so if I have these collections of lines, I can describe them in terms, not in terms of lines, but in terms of height function. So by definition, I consider, well, some point, like this MN, I look at all the at this segment and count how many vertical lines coming from this segment. So h of 1 is 0, so if I look at this point, I just look to this segment, no vertical lines goes up. If I consider h of 2 1, this is this point, I do have this vertical line, I do count it. So I have 1 here. And I do this for every point on this in this matrix. So for example, h of 3 2 is 2. So where is 3 2? 3 2 is here. So I have this vertical line and I have this vertical line on this segment. And for h of 4 4, well, I have 3 vertical lines which goes up from this segment. So if I have these collections of height functions, I know upright paths. So this is natural way how to describe these upright paths, so how many of them goes to the left of a certain specific point. And a statement which is similar to proposition 4, but for slightly different version of RSK, is that this function h of mn is the first column of Young diagram. So I start with the matrix Rij. I just take, this is actually a matrix of ones and zeros. For this matrix of ones and zeros, sorry. So first from matrix Rij, I do RSK algorithm as I did not define, but like column insertion RSK algorithm, and I obtain lambda of Mn by this algorithm. And this algorithm also generates Schur functions. So this is like a very close relative to the algorithm that I did define. Then H of MN is just the first column of this Young diagram. And this case, this is also can be proved just by, so in a certain definition of column insertion, this also just proved by this just recursion argument. So this is just the same statement which I didn't prove, but it's quite similar to what I did prove. So this is non-probabilistic result, but now let us try to say what happens probabilistically. So probabilistically, these Rij are geometric distributions, independent. So we have a dot at each point with probability, so it is zero with probability 1 minus a times a minus ai times bj, and we have a dot with this probability. So putting these dots randomly, we obtain again some statement about Schur measure, namely Schur measure with parameters a1 through am and b1 through bn is the first column of this Young diagram describes a height function in a certain vertex model. And these are the weights of this vertex model. So we can forget about dot, we can do exactly the same construction, but without like dots, about thinking about these six type of vertices. So these six type of vertices, so again, we start with horizontal lines, which goes from the left, and we look at the first column. And now in the first column, starting from the bottom and going up, we look at these probabilistic weights. So we can say, so here we have either this vertex with probability 1 minus ai times bj, or this vertex with probability ai times bj. So what corresponds to the our either we turn up or going further to the right. Then here, so we meet this probability. So it goes up, and then we have these vertices with probability 1, so nothing is happening in these vertices. And also, like at some points, like this point and this point, we choose this option. And at this point, we choose this horizontal option. So this horizontal, so this RSK algorithm can be interpreted just in terms of vertices. So this is like five vertex model. So we can have vertices of five types. So we can have like full cross, like zero, so just like this, there are no upright path, no life is here. If we have like a full intersection, there is like also no life. We do have some life when we choose between these two variants, and we also have no life here, so we cannot have a vertical line, but we always must turn to the right if we have no horizontal line there. And height function of this vertex model, stochastic vertex model, is described by a first column of Schur process. So first column has another interpretations probably like which are more close to this upright path interpretation. But if we think about this in this probably slightly strange way as about vertex model, then the natural question is why we have this probability zero. So can we somehow deform these probabilities in a way that we obtain six vertex model? And so this description is quite close to slightly different types of models. So they are called six vertex models. Or do I have something about them? Okay, so this is a statement that I already said, that first column is like distributed in the same way as a height function in the five vertex model with these weights. And now we're thinking about six vertex models. So six vertex models, so thinking very simplistically, we can, these are models of square eyes. So it's water, so it should be like 2H and 1O, hydrogen and oxygen. And we can think about this very simplistically, like that we can have six configurations. So this O can be connected with two of these four H, and we can choose which of these six choices happen, but this, of course, can be done like in a certain way, so that we can, one H is associated only with one O. So this is like some intuition. So we, this intuition why we have six vertices, and then like picture like this can be interpreted in terms, so this there is just bijections in terms of upright paths with these six vertices where these six vertices are allowed. So this is like so this is a there is a lot of research in these six vertex models, but mathematical understanding of these models is quite like below these Schur processes. So for Schur processes we know a lot, and for these six vertex models there so there are a lot of predictions, but not that much mathematically rigorous results. And certain attempt so is made how. So I will try now to explain how like one quite specific six vertex model fits into like almost Schur processes fits into the scheme of whole Littlewood processes. So I will just of course define what is it. So but it fits like relatively the same scheme as for Schur processes. So in general, six vertex models are studied. So we can take just like six weights, arbitrary six weights for these six vertices. Then we can see there's some finite volume and define just the weight of configuration subproduct of all weights. So the most studied example is probably domain wall boundary conditions when we have all paths coming here and which go out there. But there are like also like many, many examples, and there are different cases. What this, so depending on what are these six parameters, so there are like different types of behavior. So what I want to define, I just want to give some specific weights for these six vertices, which generate a whole Littlewood process. So this is just one very particular model. So it is called stochastic six vertex model. So it was introduced by Guash-Pon and studied like asymptotically, final asymptotic was found in Borodin, Korvin, Gorin. So this is already quite recent research, like asymptotic study of this model. So in my parameters, I introduce one additional real number t, so which is between 0 and 1. And now I put certain weights into these vertices. So if t is 0, then I will obtain previous weights. So this will be 0, this will be 1, and this will be my previous weights 1 minus aibj and aibj. So this is very specific choice of weights, but it turns out that for this specific choice of weights, we can analyze this model quite in detail because of this framework of which Schur process, whole Littlewood process, which comes from the algebra of symmetric function. And this is a model which well, belongs to a slightly different class because, in fact, for Schur functions, we always have non-intersecting paths in this or that sense. We do not. We do have non-intersecting paths, so we have determinants, and determinants. So we have probably some determinal correlation functions. So all the stuff that will be happen late in this course. And for this model, we do not have all these determinants, but we do have. It turns out that we do have a structure of symmetric functions. So I need to introduce whole Littlewood functions for stating the result about this model. So whole Littlewood function, so this is just an advertisement, so I will not prove anything, and the proofs are actually significantly harder than in the case of, like in the Schur case, in the case of five vertex model. But I'll try, at least try to state something. So whole Littlewood function, so there is like a lot of generalizations of Schur functions. So there are Jack functions, there are whole Littlewood functions, there are Macdonald functions, and there are actually many other functions which are either generalizations or like somehow similar to Schur functions, and similar means more or less that for all these functions, we do have the same relations that we did have for Schur functions. So we discussed for Schur functions several results. So they form a basis, they have cachet identity, so there are some nice formulas for expansions of these things in terms in linear combinations of these functions. And we have combinatorial formula for problem. Like, most importantly, we have combinatorial formula. That's why we do have some interesting combinatorics, because we have combinatorial formulas. So whole Littlewood functions, it's not very hard to define them. I will almost define them. So this is some constants which depends on lambda, which I do not state explicitly. So this is just some product. We take rows, columns, so just nice product form of which depends on lambda, but which does not depend on xi's. So this definition of polynomial, whole Littlewood polynomial. Then we sum over all permutation of indices, and we sum over these factors which do not look particularly scary. There is the same parameter t, which will be the same as we had in stochastic six vertex model. So this is not a polynomial from the first look, but it actually is. It's like in the Schur function. So for Schur polynomial, I also started with something which doesn't look like exactly a polynomial, but it's also like has van der Mond and the determinant, and in the numerator we have something antisymmetric. So this is a polynomial, and this is generally like a generalization of Schur functions in the sense that if we have t equals zero, then we obtain a Schur function. So this thing we can see that if we do not have this term, then it will be x1 to the power lambda 1 plus n minus 1. So these shifts that we discussed probably in the first lecture. So and when we symmetrize over these shifts, we exactly obtain a determinant. And for t equals 1, this becomes like even easier, like it becomes a monomial function due to this like constant factor. It will become exactly monomial symmetric functions. So we know everything for 0 and 1, but like for general t, this is actually quite mysterious object. It's not easy. So for example, the value, so this is a polynomial. So the value, it's not easy to calculate values of these polynomials. So the value of these polynomials is more or less known if we take only one so specialization into geometric progression, which depends on t. Only in this case, something is known about values of these polynomials. And for example, to evaluate this at all ones, this is just no nice formula, as far as I know, for whole Littlewood polynomials, which is quite strange. For example, for Schur functions, there is a very nice formula how to evaluate Schur function at all ones. But we do have, quite miraculously, we do have all elements of our this theory. So we have these functions form a linear basis in symmetric functions. We have combinatorial formula. So combinatorial formula for whole Littlewood polynomials is also like has a form of summing over interrelation arrays. But now each interrelation array has some weight which depends on this parameter t. So in Schur case, we have like uniform distribution on this interrelation arrays, and here we have well some factors. Sorry? Why? So you think you know the formula for it at all once? No, it's quite complicated. It's quite complicated. It's quite complicated. So it might exist. I will be happy if it exists. But I don't know. Yeah. So this is not like in this form. So it looks simple, but this is not a polynomial in this form. And when we do this division, it will become well something not very simple. Yeah.
And m lambda for the lambda.
So I don't know so how. So there should be like some continuous deformation. I have never seen something like this. So there are some geometric way how Littlewood functions appear like for fields with a finite characteristic, at least for values t which is it's equal one So but I'm not quite sure that but this is not quite what you are saying. So I have never seen anything like this. I understand. Yes, it's quite different. Yeah. Probably I don't know. Probably nobody knows. Probably only but I don't know for sure. Yeah, but there is quite a theory.
It's not geometric. It's not really related to groups. Okay, that's something. So here, I'm just thinking of you have this.
But it's interesting what is between. Yeah, thank you. It's very, very interesting. It's probably so they're not that well studied as Schur functions. So it can be that some conceptual understanding is missing. But what is present is like basically combinatorial formula, cache identity. So there is like another constant which is involved here. But basically we have the same cache identity with the products of a whole Littlewood functions in two different set of variables has a very nice product form. And this again plays an important role in asymptotic analysis of such things. So we have also skewed whole Littlewood functions just because we have combinatorial formulas. So exactly like the same way we have combinatorial formulas, combinatorial definitions for skewed whole Littlewood functions. And we have like some summation identities for them. So for specializations, we basically have the same information. So I stated Thomas' theorem about Schur positive specializations. Now for whole Littlewood positive specializations, we already see some signs that the picture is not that complete because classification is not known. So there is like a very precise conjecture. So that if you take like the same parameters alpha I and beta j's and also gamma as in the Schur case, and like somehow put this t into these formulas for p1, pk. So as I think like in the previous lecture, we had this formula for t equals zero, and these are the same formulas for which appear for general t. Then it's easier to check that these specializations are whole Littlewood positive, but the classification, the statement that there are no other whole Littlewood positive specialization. This is an open question. There is like more general open questions like for Macdonald positive specializations. So everybody uses these specializations. Everybody believes that there are nothing else. And this is quite reasonable, but nobody knows why there is nothing else here. Well, it's immediate from existing results about symmetric functions. So I'm not, I don't have time and don't have like desire to prove all these things in details. Even for Schur functions, I didn't prove for betas, probably. I just stated. So I just claim that these ones are whole Littlewood positive. This is just a claim, and I cannot make the same claim that this list is complete because this is an open question. Yes, t between 0 and 1. Yeah, this is. So holidal functions are reasonable for other t's as well, but this is between 0 and 1. So t equals, there is also like case t equals minus 1, which is like almost, this is actually basically the Schur case. So this is like almost the Schur case when the theory is as complete as for the Schur functions. But between 0 and 1, it's much more poor. So now again, so since we have whole little wood polynomials, we have Cauchy identity, and we have positive specialization, we can define a whole little wood measure for arbitrary positive specialization. And in the case when we have alpha specializations, it again takes this, this form. So if t is 0, we again obtain a Schur measure. And this is not that different. It has the same structure. And one can also, so I will not define it, but one can also define whole little wood processes. In the same way, so we consider this confusion specialization, which goes up or down, write skew Cauchy, skew whole little wood functions, use summation identities, and obtain partition function of this form. And like most, so the most importantly, that these processes can be analyzed, and this is actually was realized quite recently. So it was a paper by Borodin and Corvin about Macdonald processes, which shows how to work with this object, how to obtain a lot of interesting results, probabilistic results for Macdonald processes. So, and there is like some also further development, there were further developments after this. But we are interested only in whole little processes case now. And we return to stochastic six vertex model. So stochastic six vertex model has these weights. So now when I formulated Cauchy identity, you can see that this denominator looks particularly, well, it looks quite close to this denominator, right? So it, actually these weights come in exactly because I wanted to state a property for whole little root measure. So now, we have stochastic six vertex model. So which means, so let me repeat this procedure. So how we construct configuration in stochastic six vertex model. So we consider, basically, as an RSK case, we consider infinitely many horizontal lines which come from the left. Nothing is coming from the right. Then we look at the first column. And we have probabilities. So this probability is equal to 1, and this probability is equal to 1, which means that if you have like a full intersection, then nothing can happen. And for if we have no lines, also nothing can happen. But we can, we have a choice like this. So the sum of these two weights, it's probably possible to see that the sum of these two weights is 1. And also, the sum of these two weights is equal to 1. So that's what the case for Schur process as well, but now all these four weights are non-zero. So if we have a choice, so in this point, we have a choice either to go to the right or to go up. And this happens, so and the thing that singles out this model from six vertex models is that we can construct this configuration locally, step by step, step by step. So if we have some other weights which do not satisfy these conditions, then we cannot, so there is a local rule for construction of this path. So this is quite special case, but it's still quite general. So we have two parameters here in this construction. So we still study well, a family of six vertex models. So this is called stochastic line, probably in the space of all parameters of six vertex model. And this case falls out in the whole little wood process scheme. So because of we have these weights, so here we can just apply probabilistic procedure. So we should choose either we take this vertex or this vertex. Just toss a coin into, for example, we decided to go in this direction. Okay. Now we do the same here. So we have a choice. We can go either to the up or to the right. And for example, we decided to go up. Then we have no further choice in the first column. Because we have very special initial condition, this line will go infinitely to the right, and this line goes to the second column. But we already do not have this horizontal line. So now we look at the second column, and we look at this vertex, and we again have a choice, horizontal or going up. Okay, so let us decide to go up now. This happens with some propositive probability. And now at this point, we also have a choice, either we go to up or to the right, and now we use these two probabilities. And now we can, in unlike of Schur case when this vertex was not allowed, now we can go up. Well, and if you go up, then nothing can happen in this model as well. In this column as well, but then we go to the third level. Then probably we can have something like this here, and so on, so on. So we can define this global state as a step-by-step local rules, like for this point, but then for this point, like either inside of column or like moving along this diagonal, step by step we obtain, by this probabilistic procedure, we obtain this upright path, which of course depends on these weights. And like some understanding is that this picture, well, probably some questions about this construction of stochastic six vertex model.
Yes, does it depend, this depends on the order in which you look at vertices?
No. So order is as I tried to describe, is we can look first at here, then here, so we look starting from here, and then we look at these vertices. Or I can say that we look first at this diagonal, then we can look, then we look at this diagonal, then we look at this diagonal.
Yes.
So it's important.
You know what's to the southwest?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, so we, yes, exactly. So this is important, yes, and this is like incorporated in the definition. Yeah? Yes, exactly. So that's will be next slide. Yes. So the claim is that this part of the picture is exactly the same as for Schur processes. So first claim, and this is already proved recently, that we want to explain height function. So we have the statement about height function for t equals 0 just from RSK. This will be a statement about Schur measure. But these combinatorial constructions, it turns out that these combinatorial constructions works for general t between 0 and 1. And we have exactly the same statement, that this height function is distributed exactly as the first column of Young diagram. So we can see the whole little processes with A1, AM, B1, BN, and also there is a more general statement with this whole little processes, it is exactly the same as for Schur processes. If we look at points like here, and here, then we will obtain the whole little process by like with the same specializations as in the Schur case. So this already proved, and like very good question. So how to understand this as a part of RSK? So this is actually a work in progress, but I hope it will not last that long. So there is a like local rule, local RSK rule. So this is a basic step which I started today, how to construct this whole Littlewood RSK field and whole Littlewood measures and processes. So this is based on some recent developments of these dynamics, of understanding what dynamics generate Schur processes, whole Littlewood processes, Kubitaker processes, Macdonald processes. So there is like several papers, like Connell Pei, Borodin Petrov, and a couple of others. So this is an understanding how, like probabilistic understanding how to generate these processes. But also one can look at this purely combinatorially. This is reasonable combinatorial statements. So how to construct a RSK which has like more or less the same properties as I tried to discuss. And it exists, so for whole little functions, it will appear soon. And the idea is that we consider not a deterministic step, and this idea is for all this paper, so this is not our idea. The idea is that we consider not a deterministic step So we had deterministic algorithm, deterministic way to define rho from in the beginning of this lecture. And here idea is that we can see the random rho. So we cannot obtain something nice if rho is deterministic. But if you can see the random rho, so for three Young diagrams and input, we obtain like linear combination of diagrams or just random diagram. And this understanding is correct, and it gives us exactly this stochastic six vertex models in the case of whole little root functions. So this is like, this will, in particular, this will prove these statements like with the use of RSK, with the use of like of the same method that I discussed today for Schur functions. No, it breaks. A lot of things break. So for whole little root, we do not, there is no row insertion, basically. Only column insertion. Yes, for qubit theory, it's a row insertion. For whole little root, it's only column. So for Schur case, we have both row and column. And for like a whole little root, we have only column. And for Macdonald, we have nothing. No, it was basically the same. No, the principal difference, so like in the way, as I said, so half of the, so there are several RSKs. So in, I think in Schur case, there are 8 RSKs. Okay, so half of RSKs disappear. So there is like, so what to call row, column, dual, strict, non-strict. So there's like quite a number of similar constructions. So half of them will disappear in a qubit taker case, and another half will disappear in a whole little root case. We need this, so I'm saying about the statement about first column. So we can generate whole little process, but there is another part that first column has a nice behavior.
Okay.
So I need both. Yeah. So one can generate alpha and betas. Yes, that's one can generate.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think that's all. So this was like, last part was just some kind of advertisement. So, and this is the end of combinatorial part of this lecture. So starting from the next lecture, we will discuss asymptotics of these models. We will finally discuss asymptotics of these models. We will analyze Schur processes. And at the end, we will also analyze this whole little process, stochastic six vertex model, and obtain asymptotics. So why do we need all this, like from a probabilistic point of view? So how to obtain asymptotic results about these models, about last passage percolation, about Astec diamond, and about stochastic six vertex model.